Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to the second Humanities Happy Hour, a new virtual event series from the Humanities Institute at UC Santa Cruz, and a component of a larger program called Questions That Matter in the Time of Pandemic. My name is Lois Kazakoff. I worked for 26 years at the San Francisco Chronicle, mostly as an editorial writer and commentary editor. I'm also a proud banana slug. I graduated from UCSC in 1976. It was my time at Cowell College, however, where the motto is the pursuit of truth in the company of friends, that's most pertinent to what we're going to be talking about this evening. I'm joined today by UC Santa Cruz Associate Vice Provost for Teaching and Learning, Jody Greene. Jody's a professor of literature and has become a critical voice in the national conversation about teaching and learning in higher education. We met about 2 years ago when I gave a seminar at UC Santa Cruz about writing for a wider audience so that UC Santa Cruz professors could share their great ideas with more people. Jody had an idea for a sharp, well-reasoned commentary about an issue in the news that day, exactly what we were looking for at the Chronicle, and she had it written before I'd gotten back to my office. Building on that success, we've worked recently on two more commentary pieces for EdSource, the news website about education. Before we dive into the conversation, I'd like to talk about a few details. The event is being recorded and will be available on the Humanities Institute website. We're using a webinar tool tonight, so there is no chat function, but please do use the Q&A tool to ask us questions throughout the discussion. We'll have two periods of question and answers when we'll answer them in the middle and at the end. And to ward off Zoom fatigue, we will take a short break midway. You can refill your cheese and crackers plate or whatever else. We'll do our best to field the questions as they come in, and we'll have the bulk of the time at the end. We invite you to share your thoughts on Twitter and Instagram by tagging at UCSCTHI and using the hashtag Humanities Happy Hour. So, probably everybody knows that students in California from kindergarten through high school are sheltering at home during the pandemic and transitioning to online instruction. But Jody, what's happening for college students, and specifically what's happening at UCSC?
Yeah, so first of all, thank you for the introduction, Lois, and thank you to the Humanities Institute for putting this together. So we transitioned to fully remote instruction about a week before the end of the winter quarter. We then put all of our exams and final projects into a remote format, and then we had 1 week to prepare our approximately 1,800 spring quarter courses for remote delivery. So all of our students are learning remotely, even though we have about 1,000 UCSC undergraduates still living on campus. So that's what we've been up to.
Wow. You know, I think we hear a lot from our friends and family and neighbors and commentators on the media about, you know, when we get back to our normal lives after the pandemic subsides. But that's not what I'm hearing at UCSC. The more the discussion there is, you never let a serious crisis go to waste. What's happening?
Yeah, I mean, I think instructors in particular are not in a place right now where they want to really hear about this as an opportunity or even as a forced opportunity. It has been an incredibly difficult time for everyone on our campus, students, faculty, and staff, and the amount of extra work that's gone into accomplishing this is really almost unimaginable, and it's really given the lie to the idea that higher education can't pivot quickly. Having said that, higher education has been under a lot of stresses for a while, and we've also had quite a lot of research for a while that the way we teach may not be entirely supporting the way our students learn, and particularly the way some groups of students learn, some populations of students learn. And so it seems to me that as we have suddenly all had to learn new tools and think about learning in new ways, we at least have the momentum of a conversation about how we teach rather than what we teach for the first time in my 23 years at UCSC.
So that's how you would differentiate what was different before and now, that the conversation has changed, or
Yeah, so four years ago, I was hired by the university to begin a teaching center, and the Center for Innovations in Teaching and Learning has been a wonderful project. I have an amazing team, and UCSC is a place that's always taken education seriously, the education part of a research university seriously. Nonetheless, for everyone on campus to realize that teaching is something that they don't need to do in isolation, and that there are people who are ready to support them to rethink the strategies that they're using for teaching, I think those are, that is the beginning of a really profound change, because we tend as faculty members to be very atomized. We do our individual research, some of our STEM colleagues do it in labs, but primarily we're working alone on our own projects, and then we teach our own classes, and our colleagues don't spend a lot of time talking with us about the specifics of how we're teaching and what we're doing in our classes. So I think for me, it's that notion that we've become much more of a collective around the how we do our jobs than we have been in the past.
So what's happening right now? I mean, this is where you want to go, but what's happening right now? Are the faculty coping with this enormous change that they have to deal with right now? Is there a what we're doing now and a plan for what we're going to be doing in 6 months?
There is a plan for what we're going to be doing in 6 months. I mean, we recognize that, like all the other schools in the country on the quarter system, we already have had the experience of taking a course from beginning to end in a remote format. If you left halfway through the semester, or your students left halfway through the semester, then you finished a course where you already knew each other personally. So an end-to-end remote format is much more complicated, because you have to figure out how to create community in your classroom. And right now what we're focusing on, the team that I work with, the Instructional Continuity Working Group, is a group of people that voluntarily came together to try to figure out how the campus would support instructors. And what's happening right now is that we're focused on three areas, the areas of accessibility, community, and deep learning. So that as people transition their summer courses and probably their fall courses into remote formats, we can become much more adept at supporting student learning and building community in our courses, so that our students can feel that they're a part not only of this particular instructional activity, but of the community of UC Santa Cruz. And we've really placed that as a goal, in addition to making sure that our courses are accessible to our students.
Can you define those three things, accessibility, I don't remember what the second is, and then deep learning?
So deep learning means more than ticking boxes of completing assignments. Deep learning means what are the things that our students can learn in these online environments in a pandemic. So we want them to learn the course material that they came to learn in that class, but we also want them to learn things like how to feel like they have agency in a time when we don't have agency, how to feel like they belong to a community in a time when the community is dispersed. So there's a certain amount of life skills that we want to build in to the deep learning in these classes. We also have the opportunity that we haven't had in the past of really allowing students in some ways to do a little bit more learning at their own pace. So now we're in an environment in which all lectures are probably recorded, the vast majority of lectures are recorded. My dog might be about to start to bark. So that means that a student can go back and review those materials in the way that they can't necessarily in an in-person class, and that might promote their deep learning. As far as accessibility goes, in some ways, this is a very material issue. Do our students have the technology they need to learn in remote environments? The campus went to extraordinary lengths at quite a lot of expense and with the generosity of donors to make sure that we had laptops and tablets that we could send to students. And we did this with hundreds of laptops and tablets to students who didn't have adequate technology. But we haven't yet been able to solve the problems of students who don't have adequate internet at home. And so how do we work with municipalities around California to make sure that all students, K through 16, and people who are trying to work from home have adequate internet? In addition, we want to make sure that all course materials are accessible to all of our students. So are our PDFs in an appropriately accessible format? So we're working on accessibility in a number of different domains at the same time. As far as community goes, as I've said, we're dispersed right now, and we're trying to figure out how to use these strange tools to allow people to feel not only like they can connect with their specific instructors, but as though they belong to a community. And one of the things about distance learning that we know that makes it a little bit different from in-person learning is that in an in-person learning environment, most of the vectors of connection flow from the students to the teachers. And Lois asked me to make a slide about this. And instead of making a slide, I'll show you that when I think about these vectors, I almost always think, and this won't surprise those of you who know me, of a Buddhist stupa. So in a Buddhist stupa, you can imagine the student's attention is the prayer flags that are all heading up to the top of the stupa. In a distance learning environment, the vectors of connection have to be built between the students much more strongly than they do in an in-person environment. And so part of what we're working on for this summer is how to support instructors to design courses that have lots of opportunities for student-to-student engagement, whether that's group projects, whether that's message boards, whether that's Slack channels. And we're learning all of this as we go.
So what's the response been from the faculty? Are they like, wow, this is new and different, but what are they?
They've been like, wow, this is new and different, and we're doing this. I mean, it's actually quite hard for me to talk about how blown away I am by the instructors on our campus, both faculty members and graduate student TAs and GSIs, who did these three things. They finished one quarter, they got through finals, and they redesigned every single class for spring. All of that happened in a matter of less than 4 weeks. And, you know, people are getting used to the technology. There are problems. Nobody wants to be in an all remote environment or an all online environment. I have not spoken to a single person who thinks that this is a good idea for how universities like UCSE should be, although there are many very successful universities that are all online. That's not what our university is, but that's not really the right question, Lois. What I think my colleagues have done is they've said, wow, we need to keep teaching. Our students need to keep learning. So we're going to figure out how to do the best we can with these tools, and then we're going to get better at it, so that in the summer we do better than we did this quarter, and in the fall we can really roll out an education that meets this moment.
What do you hear from the students?
We hear from the students that they prefer in-person instruction, which is not a surprise. We also hear from the students that they find remote learning very difficult in many cases, although we also hear from students who are actually enjoying remote learning and are happy to be away from some of the social dynamics of in-person learning. But one of the things about this conversation that's really tricky is that right now, nationally, we are laying all of the problems that are associated with learning at every level at the feet of the platforms that we're using. So the problem is remote learning. But every single student in this country, and also those of us who are teaching them, is experiencing some level of trauma at this time. So we have lots of research from the past to tell us that in-person instruction, when people are traumatized, does not lead to good learning. So if students are not learning right now, or they're not learning as well as they were in person, it's a little bit hard to say that that's entirely the result of the fact that we're delivering this remotely. It also has to do with the fact that they're really stressed and traumatized. And part of our job is to build courses that effectively deliver instruction, but also to build in ways to support our student resilience. And so the CITL and our partners have been leading workshops on how to support student resilience during this time and how to help them find community and care that they need so that they can keep learning in these absolutely unprecedented times.
And what does that care look like? Is it a person or a number you dial? Or I mean, what?
It's all of those things. So it's instructors surveying their students regularly. And we've seen this really across the board, checking in with their students, finding out how they're doing, making sure that they know where the resources are, right? When we're under stress or trauma, we're cognitively impaired. So you might have told your students last week, if you're having technological trouble, contact these people, and then they'll tell you the next week that they don't remember anything that you said about that. So one of the things that we're having to do is repeat ourselves, and mostly it's just really to humanize the learning environment. People are finding amazing ways to start their classes with either just a basic check-in or going around if it's a smaller class and asking students, you know, what's one thing that you've done that's delightful this week, or what's one thing that you've read that has meant something to you this week? Is there any way that we can connect your learning to what you're actually experiencing in these times? And, you know, for the students who are really struggling or who are in home environments that are difficult for them, making sure that we get them connected with the resources that they need. The advisors are working overtime. I mean, I mostly work with instructors, although I work on a team almost exclusively of staff members, but everybody in the campus community is working to do everything we can to support our students during this time.
You had mentioned in one of our earlier conversations about the Zoom Core. What's the Zoom Core?
The Zoom Core is the brainchild of Jay Olson, who works in the instructional technology unit at the institution and has been with the humanities division for as long as I've been at UCSC, which is nearly a quarter century. And at the beginning of the term, we realized that instructors, it's very difficult to teach, monitor the chat, see who's raised their hand, and make sure that all the technology is working at the same time. And so Jay had this brilliant idea that we could repurpose student workers who might not be working because the units that they work for are not functioning in the same way right now. And they would be paired with an instructor. So basically you would have a Zoom babysitter who could do things like monitor the chat, answer questions, help you if you needed to do something technological that wasn't working for you, or just be another pair of eyes, a kind of a technological pair of eyes. And starting in the summer, we're looking forward to creating an accessibility core who will support instructors by taking their course materials and making sure that they're in accessible formats. So instead of asking every instructor to become an expert at document accessibility and web accessibility, we're going to have students who help with that. And that also allows them to feel like they're contributing something in this time, and it allows us to keep them employed.
It also sounds like you're training up a whole new core of teachers.
Yes, I hope so. I mean, I hope that they'll see enough of the other side of instruction, what it looks like from the teacher side. Obviously, you know, some of those more technical skills like the Zoom skills, we imagine will not be a part of instruction going forward, but making sure that all of our documents are accessible is a part of instruction. And so that's something that we hope will continue after this crisis is over.
Is there some way for the students to say, this is working, but this isn't working so well? How do they communicate with you?
So they have a number of ways of doing that. They don't hesitate, many of them, if something's not working well, to reach out to someone. And they don't necessarily all reach out in the same way. For the first time ever, actually, the Teaching Center has been receiving mail directly from students asking questions like, my laptop's not working, or I can't do this thing that I need to do. We have an ITS help desk that sorts hundreds of tickets from students and instructors and staff members every day. But we've also had various ways of reaching out. So there's a survey that's just about to go out to students that's specifically about the technological tools and platforms. It's not so much about the instructional practices, but which of these platforms worked for you and which of them posed particular problems that we may not know about so that we can do better in the summer and presumably in the fall as well. And then they always have their end of term student experience of teaching surveys, formerly known as evals, to talk about the instructional practice piece of this. So they have a number of avenues to get the word out.
Okay, so we've talked about how the faculty is dealing with and how the students, but you know, Santa Cruz has such a large outreach in the community itself, both in Santa Cruz and to the alums. How's that changing and how is that going?
Well, I mean, I think this event is a great example of the ways in which we are wanting to be in conversation with our communities, and we're also wanting to let our communities know what kinds of things a public university is doing in this time. You know, whether it's starting a testing lab, as our amazing colleagues over in MCD Biology did, or offering public events like this that help people, and this is the particular gift of the humanities, that help people think about what's happening for us right now. I mean, this to me is the perfect thing for a humanities division to do in a time like this. What are the questions that matter? And how can we come together when we're isolated from each other? I'm no great fan of technology, but I think it's absolutely amazing that we have 200 people together tonight talking about the university during and after a pandemic. And I don't think that we didn't put one of the things that I, okay, I'm going to say something totally controversial now. One of the things that I love about this time is that we are not afraid as academics and as a university to just throw something out there and try to find a way to talk about it. We usually plan things and we study for a long time, and this has upended the temporality of scholarship. And that's not to say that there's anything wrong with the temporality of scholarship, but universities, through people like you, Lois, have been trying to figure out how to be better at connecting in real time and in basic language with the publics that we serve and live among. And this event is a great example for me. And don't worry, I wasn't paid to plug this event. It's that it seems to me to really, to just exemplify what's possible in this moment. It's like we're coming together in the town square to talk about an issue that matters. We're not trying to say it perfectly or get everything right. We're opening questions and trying to connect with each other to talk about them in a time when we're separated from each other.
Well, this is, if we weren't asking questions like this at this period, there'd be something seriously wrong. I mean, we have to rethink everything about every aspect of our lives. So this is
a conversation
to be having. I think what we'll do now is I'm gonna read a couple of questions from the listeners, and then we'll take a short break. So the first question is, online higher education started approximately 20 years ago and other forms of distance learning decades before. I keep wondering why this current shift to learning has been such a major upheaval. This is from Ellen Slavitz.
Yeah, I mean, there are institutions that I don't think it's been such an upheaval for everyone. It's been an upheaval for those sectors of higher ed, and I'm just going to restrict my comments to higher ed because I don't know a lot about how K-12 is experiencing this. I know a lot about how the children and parents I know are experiencing it. But this, this is a difficult shift for those institutions that have specialized in residential in-person instruction. And so I would say the more surprising thing is, how is it possible that a place that had as little use of instructional technology and educational technology has managed to pull this off so quickly? And one answer to that is that good teaching is good teaching. And so we have a very long tradition of commitment to teaching at UCSC, and what we've done is put different tools into people's hands. But the fact is, we don't have a large catalog of online courses at UCSC. We really value the in-person experience, and so do our students, and so do our alumni. But we may, through this experience, find out that there are some things that technology can help us do, and there are some ways that technology can introduce maybe even some greater educational equity that we probably wouldn't have found out without the pandemic.
Okay. So here's the next question. What do you mean specifically by student agency? This is from a UCSC grad student and TA. What kind of feedback have you gotten from TAs and GSRs?
So I don't know what kind of feedback we're getting from TAs and GSRs. I'm thinking about student agency in terms of very micro level. So in the ordinary course of things, we don't give students a choice about how to show their learning in their classes. They have a final paper or a final exam or a final project. And one of the things that the Teaching Center and online education and the rest of the Instructional Continuity Working Group, those of us who are working on the how of teaching, have been suggesting to instructors is give students some choice in how they want to show their learning. Right now, it is very beneficial for them to feel like they have agency, right? You can't leave your house. People are telling you what to do. So whether it's asking students whether they want to change the readings on the course, asking students, do you want us to do a unit where we think about statistics on the pandemic, or are you tired of thinking about the pandemic? So including them in decision-making is a way of actually supporting resilience, and this is supported in the literature on trauma and resilience, by restoring to people a sense of their own agency.
Okay. Could you talk a little bit about the fact that UCSC's on the quarter system, other universities are on the semester system. Did that make things harder, easier? How did it add to the workload? How did that play out?
Well, I think it made a huge difference. I mean, one of the things that's been interesting to me writing for the higher ed press, which I've never done before the last couple of months, is just, I didn't really realize the degree to which the semester is the default model for the country. So I had to keep saying over and over again to the editors that I was working with, no, you don't understand. We've already gone almost finished, start to finish, with fully remote courses. So if you've already known your students and then you transition to a Zoom format, that can work fairly well. But it's extremely difficult to start and finish a course on Zoom. So the downside of this is that we're all very tired. The upside of it is we've already had the chance to design start to finish for these remote environments. And that gives us a chance to, you know, everybody teaching this quarter had a chance to try various things and see what worked for them in their teaching, see what worked for big courses, small courses. And we are flooded with inquiries right now from people who want to significantly redesign what they're doing for summer and even for fall. So I think it's put us a little bit ahead of the game to have already had to go through this third quarter in a start to finish remote format.
And how many courses are in the summer? Is it like
about 400 courses in the summer, and then we'll go to about 1900 courses in the fall. And of course, in the fall, the very particular challenge, and I was in a meeting about this afternoon, one of the particular challenges that we have for the fall is bringing in our first year students. How do we give them a sense of community? How do we teach them how to learn at the university level and also teach them how to learn remotely at the same time? And how do we set them up? You know, there's a real urgency to this for us. How do we set them up so that they can progress through their UCSC degree as fluidly as possible, knowing that there are challenges associated with fully remote learning. So we feel like we have to hold ourselves to a very high standard, and I think we can do it. I mean, I feel like I work with the best team in the world, and if it's possible to do this remote learning thing well, this team is going to figure out how to help instructors do that.
Is there some sort of national higher education committee group that's sharing ideas on all of this?
Everyone is sharing ideas. At the beginning of this 10-week period that we're in, I was using this phrase radical sharing a lot, because people who work at teaching centers know that we already share everything. So when you start a teaching center, if you want to make your life a lot easier, you go out and ask other teaching centers, can I borrow your workshop on this? Do you have any materials on that I can share with my faculty? And I loved it. And it was a really, it was a kind of liberation for me to get out of the individualized proprietary part of scholarly life, which wasn't very motivating for me. So there is already a lot of sharing between centers of teaching and learning, but also, people have harnessed platforms like Twitter and Facebook to create groups, and in particular to create disciplinary groups. So when, you know, the environmental studies and ecology and evolutionary biology people came and said, what do we do about field courses? I said, talk to the other people who have field courses, because you all are figuring this out. And this kind of collaborative approach to teaching both within an institution and across institutions was very, very rare before 10 weeks ago. And so I would say, while there are plenty of national organizations, including the Professional Developers Network, that have jumped in to help here, it's really lateral community building in digital spaces that's creating these, that's allowing us to move as quickly as we are.
Okay. That's great, Jody. So we're going to take a short break now. You can go refill your crackers and cheese plate or your wine glass, perhaps. And I'll queue up some more questions from listeners. So why don't we come back in 4 minutes? Is that enough to get the crackers on the plate? So I'll see you at 6:05. Okay, we're back now. We're ready to resume our discussion with Jody Greene about the future of learning at UCSE, at the UC Santa Cruz Humanities Institute Humanities Happy Hour. So I wanted to do two questions, and then we're going to kind of dive into your latest essay that's on the blog for the Humanities Institute. So we have, here's a question. How have the graduate student layoffs impacted the switch to remote learning? Are graduate students Zoom babysitters now?
As far as I know, the Zoom core is undergraduate students. I don't know absolutely that there are no graduate students, but my understanding of the purpose of that was to repurpose undergraduate student workers. I think the main thing that the layoffs did was require last minute redesigns of courses because there was some curriculum shuffling at the last moment. And so, I think that has been the primary effect. The campus was already, really thinking about our teaching labor politics when we went into this. And so I would say that has been a consistent undercurrent through the conversation all the way along. What does it mean to teach? How do we organize teaching in our universities? Are there more equitable ways that we could be organizing the teaching labor of our universities? And I suspect that that conversation will be one that continues during and after the pandemic, and it's long overdue.
Okay. Next question. I'm a professor of environmental studies at Humboldt State. I'm determined to make connection community my pedagogical priority next semester. How can we combat isolation in our course materials and virtual delivery? I'm seeking concrete strategies. And could you offer citations for teaching in a trauma-sensitive way? A lot of questions there.
Yeah, so in terms of teaching in a trauma-sensitive way, there's a woman named Mays, M-A-Y-S, Imad, I-M-A-D. If you Google her, there are recordings of recent webinars that she's given on trauma-informed pedagogy that are specific to the COVID-19 moment. And there's also, this is one of the things that I'll just say this. As researchers, it often, in university settings, it often doesn't occur to us that we can Google search things that we want to know about teaching that other people research. And so I happen to know from having done an initial search a month ago myself that if you Google trauma-informed pedagogy higher ed, then you will find some really great materials. Putting higher ed on the end of things just makes your life a little bit easier. But as I say, Mays Imad is a particularly good example there. As far as creating community and collectivity in your classes, I think when we think about this, we often think that we have to be a part of those communities. And I think putting your students into Slack channels, I think giving them from the very beginning projects to work on together. One example would be an exam wrapper. So your students take a low to medium stakes exam, and then instead of just giving them a grade, you let them work through the exam together and figure out what they got right and what they got wrong. That's a very concrete strategy that a lot of people on our campus are using to help students come together. And if you contact me after this webinar, I'm happy to give you more examples. I will also say that we're learning this as we go. It's a conversation that's happening on this campus, but we really want to put community at the center of what we do.
And the question about isolation of course materials and virtual delivery?
Yeah, I think the way you have them be less isolating is that you make sure that you have engagement activities, both individual engagement activities, and that could be as simple as you assign a reading, and then you have a Google Doc or a message board where students answer some question, and they all put their answers in there, and they can read what each other is saying. So part of what you want is also to get them talking back and forth in those environments. So making sure that whether you're using the learning management system, I don't know which one you have, whether you're using Google Docs, you're giving people opportunities for engagement. I'll give you an example. I'm doing a little event next week that has to do with sort of how to take care of your spiritual wellness. during these times. And I've posted a document beforehand that's a kind of a virtual commonplace book. And I've invited the 80 people who've signed up to put one little snippet of poetry or prose in there that has helped them, has given them courage, has given them solace in these times. So that's an example where they won't have met each other yet. They probably won't meet each other in there, but they have an opportunity to engage with each other and create something together before we've even had a chance to meet. And I'm hoping that that's going to give us a sense of community when we come together, because we're all going to have this document with all of our courage-inspiring words.
Okay, great. So I just want to go touch on the essay that you wrote for the Humanities Institute, Imagining the Post-Pandemic University, a homework assignment. In that, you argue that this is a time for bold creativity and not clinging to the past. In fact, you said, some of the habits and practices we were accustomed to and immersed in pre-pandemic may not and probably should not return. Mm-hmm. What can you say about the habits and practices that you think should go away?
So we've known for a long time that some of the practices that are very common in higher education teaching are not particularly conducive to student learning and or are particularly promote particular barriers for students from specific demographic groups. So for instance, if you have a syllabus that is very schematic, doesn't have a lot of information in it, and if you write assignments that say things like, write a 5 to 7 page paper on X, and that's the totality of the instruction, first generation college students may not be able to succeed in your class, as well as students who sort of grew up with the roadmap to how to succeed in higher education written on the walls of their house. So what I think is important about the shift to remote instruction is that it's forced us all to make our courses the sort of, I always think of it as kind of like the endoskeleton of our courses becomes the exoskeleton of our courses, because students need to be able to see all the pieces and they need lots more instruction from us, especially when you're teaching students who are stressed and traumatized. You're going to have to spell everything out in words of one syllable. And so I think a lot of the tacitness that has historically disadvantaged students will learn not to have so much tacitness. Another example that I refer to in the piece is it originally said 500 to 600 person lecture hall and someone took the number out. But I was thinking about lectures, that was you, Lois. I was thinking not about the lecture course in general. I only taught lecture courses for 22 years here. I love lecture courses. I think they have great attributes to them. But the very static, very large lecture courses might not need to be delivered in the way that we've been delivering them for a while, and we're by no means the only campus that's having this conversation. What if, to give you an example, the chemistry faculty got together and they decided that for the Chemistry 1 sequence, they were going to work together to create a set of videos, short videos, in which the primary information that needs to be delivered in that class is delivered. And so the burden of lecturing on information is put in a kind of a digital textbook form. So you've got your textbook and you've got your video textbook, and then class time can be used in other ways. So maybe not all the students are coming to class at the same time, or maybe they're in modular classrooms where they're working on active learning activities together. These are known as hybrid courses, but I think there's some direction that we can go at this time in rethinking some of the formats, and especially that format, right, which has just gotten bigger and bigger and bigger on our campuses.
Can you say more about what the research shows about what's ineffective in promoting learning and what we can do to enhance the...
Well, you know, I think sometimes about a ski class, right? If you're teaching ski school and you've got 10 students in your class, that's an incredibly challenging thing to do, right? You're trying to help each one of those students modify their style. You're trying to have them not go off a cliff. You're trying to make sure there's always 10 of them in the room. right? And it's very, very difficult to give the kind of personalized attention that students need. If you have 600 people learning chemistry in your class, how do you have any kind of granular sense of what each of those sort of minds needs in order to help them, right? You're trying to deliver a single package, and there's very little ability to do adaptive learning in that learning environment. We also know that who asks the questions? The students with the most privilege ask the most questions. Sometimes it's just one student who asks all the questions. So there's all these voices in there that may feel like, well, okay, if I already feel like people might worry that I'm not smart enough to be here, I'm certainly not gonna raise my hand and ask a sincere question in this class. So it's very, very hard to track who's keeping up with you. And it's also difficult to make sure that all people feel equally and able to get help from you.
Okay. So what would you like to see happen in the near term at UCSC and maybe nationwide?
I would like to see a conversation about what people think higher education should be. I've had a few conversations with people this week about the recommendations that I made in this piece, and I found this so incredibly comical because there is only one recommendation in the piece, and that is that we have a conversation. And in particular, that we have a conversation about what we would like higher education teaching and learning to look like if we took the constraints off the conversation. So I have a dear friend, I'm going to give her a call out here, my friend Suzanne Alonzo in the Ecology and Evolutionary Biology Department, goes through an activity with her graduate students when they're starting to think about their research projects. And she says, let's take material constraints off the table right now. What would you most like to study? What do you want? What kind of a research project do you want to devise? What do you want to learn? How do you want to go about learning it? And I think if we could get together and engage in that kind of an activity and really imagine together, that's why I use this term poiesis that's so much a part of the literary arts and the humanities. Really, I'm asking people to use their imaginations to figure out what they want. We are so good at critique in the humanities in this time, and we're so good at pointing out where the flaws are, and of course you need to do that. But right now, everything is kind of in tatters. And I'm not saying that we're going to have total control over what we build, but I think we have been given an opportunity to imagine that we might do things otherwise. And as a community, as a campus community, students, faculty, staff, administration, everybody, I would like to see us engage in a conversation about what we want UCSC to be and how we want to do things, and then see which of those things we can do.
So will the pandemic help you do that?
I think the pandemic is already helping us do that. I mean, look, here we are, right? I haven't had a conversation in 23 years here about what people want a university to be. So I think it is an opportunity to start conversations that we might not already have been able to have. And I also think that people's hunger for connection is going to lead us. I also think that when we're in, you know, large scale death situations, and we're in one of those right now, both the death of social forms and the death of actual human beings, that's why I like this phrase, questions that matter. It makes us want to talk about what matters to us, because we see that things that we love and people we love might go away. And to me, you know, I always like things better when they get real. That is, I am not comfortable being in a place of bad faith or where we're all just pretending that everything's going on fine. So what I like about this moment is we can say, okay, you know, what wasn't working so well at the university and for whom, and how might we go about fixing that when we start things up again, whenever that happens.
So how can we harness the humanities to think boldly and creatively about reimagining the university?
Well, it is the natural home of the imagination. And so I think it's a particular place where we feel relatively comfortable with speculation. When there isn't enough information, we're willing to go ahead and speculate to create a kind of a possible world. I mean, that's what I love about this term poiesis, which, you know, is very much a part of my teaching. My teaching was primarily about the history of the category of literature. And there has been a debate since the Greeks about whether or not literature is dangerous because it has this capacity to create alternative worlds, or whether in fact it's one of the most powerful tools that we as human beings have, this imaginative world making. And UCSC has a long history of world making. We have scholars like Anand Singh, Donna Haraway, Rob Wilson, who have been talking to us about the importance of world making activity, and that we as critical intellectuals should not only be engaged in critique, but should also be engaged in the practice of imagining new worlds. And I think this is a perfect moment for us to harness that imaginative power to really try to, sketch out what we want the university to look like. We don't have enough information yet to fill in the information, but far from making us afraid to engage in this conversation, I actually think it's the best time. And this is what I took from Jonathan Lear. When the world as you knew it has fallen into devastation, and the world that will come into being hasn't come into being yet, one option is to sit in dread or nostalgia, and the other is to engage in some imaginative world making and start thinking about how you might move towards the world you want.
Jody, I'm awed and challenged by what you put out there, and I'm gonna hope that the listeners are as well. So I'm gonna read a couple more questions before we end, because we want people to have a chance to ask you what they're worried about. So the next one is, I work in a public high school. We've been told to give all students an A, even if the work is minimal because of various reasons. How is grading being done at UCSC with remote learning?
Yeah, thank you so much for that question. And, you know, I think everyone on the call probably knows, but just in case you don't, that UCSC was really distinctive as one of the few higher education institutions in the country that didn't have grades. And I was lucky enough to come to UCSC when we didn't have grades and to see what it did to the intrinsic motivation of the students in our classes. So, I just want to say, and this also is a gesture at Kathy Davidson, who was a visitor here for the Center for Innovations in Teaching and Learning. We recirculated that event for this. And Kathy's book, The New Education, talks about what happened to US higher education when things like grades, credit hours, disciplines, multiple choice tests, all these sort of educational strategies that were associated with a particular kind of productivity and sorting of people, how those changed the character of American higher education. And one of my hopes is that we might take this as a moment to imagine that those are not the best way to go about assessing whether our students are learning. So at UCSC, under remote instruction, we still have grades, but I think the conversation is one about generosity, recognizing that if our students learned anything at all during this time, it's an absolute miracle given what they're facing, given the level of stress they're under. And so I think, you know, people will be issuing grades, but for the most part, they will be issuing grades that recognize that it is an achievement just to have stayed learning in a time when most of us want to crawl under the bed and hide.
Okay. All right, next question. When I joined UCSC in 1965, the vision of distance learning was televised instruction. Mm-hmm. I'm impressed by the sophistication of today's approach. Will the faculty and students want to return to familiar forms of face-to-face instruction as soon as possible? Or will they adopt a new normal in the future? In other words, will there be long-term changes in university instruction?
I think the answer is yes and yes to your question. So I have absolutely no doubt in my mind that we will return to in-person instruction. Everybody has made it crystal clear that if you are able to go to a university that has residential in-person instruction, that is what you want, and that is a highly valued. But I also think there will be long-term changes, and I think that's a good thing. I think a lot more people will be recording their lectures. either distributing them to students in advance or making them available to students afterwards, perhaps just in a verbal form. And we've known for a long time that that is a really help. Students have been asking us for that. And I was one of the people who really didn't want to do that. There's all kinds of issues associated with intellectual property. However, our students learn better when they're able to review the material. So if it's not giving our lectures, can we find other ways to use technology to share material with our students instead of keeping such a tight hold over it as some of us, and again, I count myself among those, have done. Lots more of us will share our slides, right? Many of us may do more digital office hours than we did before, right? So that students who maybe can't come during the actual hour of our office hours can interact with us in another format. So I think there will be long-term changes. I also think we will have a larger catalog of online, fully online courses than we've had before. And I don't see that as a bad thing. I'm not talking about a massive scale-up of online education, but some of our students want to go home, not pay Santa Cruz rents in the summertime, and keep moving through their course requirements. So can we make really high quality online courses available to them? That is an equity issue, right? We want to shorten time to degree for our students. One of the ways that we can do that is make courses available to them in alternative formats. So I think the large difference is that most of us will now be delivering some degree of technologically enhanced education. I think the smaller change is we'll have a little bit larger library of online courses for our students who want to learn in that way.
Jody, thank you so much. You've given us a look at what's happening now and the concerns now, and then opened this window to this really promising future for UCSC and higher education in general. And I hope that the listeners will share your enthusiasm for this opportunity of the pandemic, the positive in the pandemic. So, I'd like to thank the Humanities Institute, the Humanities Development Office, and the University Relations Special Events Team for making this event possible. Please stay tuned to the news about the next Humanities Happy Hour, which we hope to hold in June. So thank you so much for joining us, and good night.